Programming will not be seen tonight in order that we may bring you the following WTAE-TV special presentation.
This WTAE-TV, WDVE, A Salute to Myron Cope, is sponsored in partnership with Giant Eagle. It takes a giant to make life simple. By Subway, with over 100 locations in western Pennsylvania. Subway, the way a sandwich should be. And by Sprint PCS, bringing the wireless internet into the palm of your hand.
Myron and I have been together in the Steeler booth for six seasons, six wonderful seasons, but his association with me goes back, oh heck, to the late 60s when I was a disc jockey at TAE Radio and Myron first started doing his commentaries. And as a matter of fact, I was in on the meeting when we kicked around some possibilities of people who might work as commentators for sports in the morning. And finally, Ron Reininger, rest his soul, said, "Go get Myron Cope. That guy's colorful." Well, Ron knew exactly what he was talking about.
Myron, I'm so old, I remember when you used to be a writer. Of course, you are even older, but why point that out? You and I and Jimmy Breslin and Mickey Spillane all used to write for a magazine called Cavalier. You and I made it to television. Whatever happened to Breslin and Spillane? If you had stuck to writing, then you could have appeared here on the sports reporters and gotten a national reputation. Mike Lupica would have loved it. He would have had someone he could poke up. But you decided you would rather be unknown outside of Pittsburgh. And you are. In Pittsburgh, when you've been in broadcasting 30 years, they make a big fuss about it. I've been in broadcasting for 30 years, but in the big city, they don't even notice it. Don't you think it's a miracle that two guys with voices like yours and mine have been on the air all these years? I hope we never have to take honest jobs. Myron, congratulations. You outlived U.S. Steel.
As a neighbor and as a colleague, in a sense, working with Myron through the years, you know, it was no question a pleasure. And, you know, I think he's good people. And just like all the people in Pittsburgh, he's a Pittsburgher and good people.
Tonight, we salute 30-year Steelers color man and Pittsburgh icon of the airwaves, Myron Cope.
Yoy!
Join us for the next hour as we pay tribute and roast the legendary Myron Cope.
All right, there you go.
Oh,
welcome to Myron Cope's 30 years of broadcasting the Pittsburgh Steelers dinner and roast this evening. I'm Jim Krenn of WDVE, and it's my pleasure to be here with my good buddy from WTAE, Andrew Stocky, this evening.
I'll tell you, Jim, thank you. In a world where there aren't very many original people, Myron is an original. Myron makes us laugh, he makes us think, he's changed our entire vocabulary. I mean, let's face it, before Myron, did anybody say the word yoy? Okel dokel? And, I mean, Myron single-handedly has made cranium a hot word once again. And tonight, along with many of his good friends, close associates, and family, we're here to roast him and celebrate him, tease him a little bit, but really show how much we all love him and what he's done, not only for Pittsburgh and for the Steelers, but really for all of sports and all fans everywhere.
The voice, it's always the voice. You know, I have friends who come here and visit, and the only thing they can talk about is the sportscaster with the crazy voice.
Just that he's been in Pittsburgh for his entire life, and he's a personality that can be related to the town and to the city and to the sports programs.
Stay with us and salute 30 years of Myron Cope.
A team with a lot of character, because not only did they come back after a terrible start, but they're a big game team, and they're here in a hostile setting, but as Chuck Noll points out, well, they love it that way. It just gets them all the more up. You can't get on their back and expect them to fall apart, because they'll stand in there and just get very sore.
I go way back with Myron more than anybody at this table. I knew Myron when he was 16 years old, and he was at Taylor Allardyce High School with my brother. And I was in junior high school at Taylor Allardyce at the time. Obviously, I was a lot younger than Myron, so that's how that took place. And while
Myron was at Alderdice. He wrote a column for the school paper, and it was called Cope's Corner. Now, you see, his real name is Myron Copelman. I don't know how many people in the room know that. Myron Copelman is his real name. But in the paper, it was Cope's Corner because it fit. And that's how he got his name, and that's how he ended up using it ever since. So my brother and Myron played softball together. And I used to go watch the games. My brother played center field. He was very good. Myron was a third baseman. And Myron was always mouthing off. I mean, no matter what was going on, he just never shut up. Every time it was a close play, it never went his way. He would argue with the officials. My brother got so frustrated, he ran in from center field. He grabbed Myron, threw him over the fence into a bunch of bushes. And Myron yelled, "Yoy." That's where it started, right there. And double yoy was, "Don't throw me in the bushes twice." His TV career had a lot of moments, as you saw up there. You know, the deep sea and the Vaughan River. He did the musical with MC Hammer, sang Achy Heart, and did a series of Christmas carols, the best of all being "Deck the Broncos, They're Just Yonkos." You remember that? Unlike some record sales, you know, they didn't go from gold to platinum. They just sort of disappeared off the face of Earth at that point in time. But he's done a lot of memorable television commercials. And Myron, now that I'm back on, the one that's really got me, you're doing this thing where you, for Subway, where you sing and dance and you play an accordion and you tell the world that there's a kielbasa sandwich named after you. I got to tell you, Myron, I don't think a nice Jewish kid like you should be eating kielbasa. No less having a kielbasa sandwich named after you. But you do what you have to do. There's one here I just can't pass up because, you know, Myron does come from good stock. His father was a poor man whose family came from Eastern Europe. He made a living doing construction work. And to this day, if you go up to Bartlett Street in Squirrel Hill, you'll notice that the homes that his father worked on, some tilt to the left, some tilt to the right. And his father said, "It's not my fault. You know, we had nothing but secondhand tools to work with, and I was using a terrible trowel."
Funniest memory of Cope in the booth. It's got to be when he bumped his head on the monitor. They had to reposition the monitor from in front of us up to the corner. And they put it on a stand, and it's well anchored up there. But it's right at the height of Myron's head when he jumps up and gets excited, which often happens. And when he dinged that monitor, not once, but twice during the same broadcast, then it was decided by the stadium management they had to put foam rubber padding around it. I've suggested that they put foam rubber padding throughout all the walls and floors of the booth and the ceiling. I can't believe the amount of energy expended from the time he goes on with the pregame show until the time he leaves Cope's cabana. I mean, you're talking about a guy who's going 110 miles an hour, flank speed, for almost 9 hours. And you look at Cope in that 135-pound body and you say, where does this energy come from? I have no idea. I wish you'd tell me his secret.
Yoy and double yoy. 151 to go. Holy smokes! And we got ourselves a tooth-and-nail ball game once more. Here comes Slash and his team in the face of adversity. And I want to tell you, Dirk Dawson, the all-time everything center, he took on that Brent Alexander, the safety man. He bounced him flying once, then he went up on him, and he bounced him flying again. And I'm telling you, Dirk Dawson double blocked that guy's brains out of him.
Now, Myron's got a different style, right? Okay, so the first game, we're, you know, just like I'm telling you, I'm trying to fit in, and I just don't want to get anybody mad at me. I don't want to get fired. And and all of a sudden, you know, Myron's got the style, and LaVon Kirkland makes a great tackle. I mean, he just plants him, and Myron jumps up. Now, there's a monitor right up here, so we can watch the replay. And I don't even know how Myron could reach that thing, but Myron jumps out of his seat, and he hits it, and goes, ah! And he's going, ah!
And I look at Bill and I'm thinking, are we on the air? And he goes, but that does not deter him. No, he jumps up like he's going to make a tackle. I'm thinking, is he going to tackle Bill? Is he going to tackle me? And he starts doing this, like this dance right here. And he goes, and that was a lovely tackle by the dear Levon. Do you not think, Tunch? You know, Myron never loses an argument. He is the best arguer. We were doing the Cleveland game this year, and the Steelers are killing Cleveland. I mean, just wipe them. And I said, you know what? I go, this would be, if I was Chris Palmer, the head coach of the Browns, this is a good time to play their first pick, Tim Couch. And Myron said, this is a terrible time. You don't want to bring him in, and he could lose his confidence, and he could get hurt, and he's just going on and on and on. About a half a minute left, half a minute later, they put Tim Couch in. And he says, well, Palmer's wrong too, Tunch, and you're wrong, and you're all wrong, because I'm the genius, and I know. And then I get a letter from one of my neighbors that says, be kind to Myron, Tunch. Because we argue a lot. We're arguing, should they go for the first down? Should they punt? And when we argue a lot, he says, be kind to Myron. I'm the one that gets tagged. I'm the one that comes home with a bloody nose and a black eye. This guy has never lost an argument, ever. And I love the song. What the songs? Those are great. I love the Macarena and all the... You know, last year in Tennessee, we're playing the Oilers, and he's writing a song. You know, we're in Music City, home of country music. He's going to write a country song, and I walk by him. He's busy scribbling away, writing. He says, Tunch, stop. He said, you're a country music fan. He goes, give me the melody of a song. I'm thinking, wow, cool. Me and Myron are having a collaboration. He says, I need the melody of a country song. And I said, are you going to sing it? He said, yes. And I said, on the air? He said, yes. And I said, you need a melody? He goes, yes. I go, what difference does it make with the melody? Whether it's the Macarena or Copes Cabana or Achy Break, it all sounds the same. It's you just go, rah, 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 rah. As a player, early in my career, there's always going to be a warm spot in my heart for Myron because when I was a young player and I was struggling and I was taking a lot of heat from the media, Myron was always in my corner, and I always remember Myron saying, but I think he's a good player, and he always stood up for me, so I'll always be very, very fond of Myron. And I tell people, I had the greatest job in the world for 14 years, and now I got the second greatest. I get to talk about Steeler football and argue with Myron. God bless you, Myron. It's great to see you.
Thank you, Tom.
Put on their TV in Arkansas. They'll see them cows a-buying. They'll break down and start a-crying, cause they're missing fun that almost breaks the law. Tell your heart, your achy, breaky heart, the cow's coming back with miracles. The news I'll give him a start. He'll go crazy for the fork and buy every other cow at the Kmart. You can tell your brother Cliff if he ain't drunk himself.
He's very funny, but he's down to earth that he gets the point across.
There's only one Myron Cope.
If you were to describe Myron Cope to those outside the universe of Copenuts, what would you say? He's excitable.
That was a shovel pass, Pierce, to me, you know, the old coal, the coal into bin there, business to Hodge, and Hodge goes in, nothing but a nice day around him.
He's creative.
Mr. Sledge, go fall off a ledge, you got to go here.
He's controversial. And he's whimsical.
Those Broncos, they're just yonkos. There's Joanne Elway, traversing like a railway. Trample Elway, Icy's department. Hit that rich kid with a manhole lid.
All these characteristics have combined to make Myron a Pittsburgh institution. In a town where many broadcasters have left their mark on sports and its franchises, Myron Cope has built a reputation of telling it like it is, punctuating these opinions with his famous yoys and double yoys.
Yoy! Look out! Look out! Dallas! Just for practice, the dogs have bitten Sam Ratigliano on the ankle! Mercy sakes!
The store opened for Myron at WTAE in 1968. Year he made the leap from print to electronic sports journalism. Initially, though, he had to get the audience accustomed to his voice, or squawk, as some listeners have described it.
The boy, when I came on the air in the morning, that switchboard lit up. People were screaming at the station, get that voice off your station. I can't listen to that when I wake up in the morning. But they hung in there with me, and I guess people became inured to it.
Myron's growing popularity caught the attention of the Pittsburgh Steelers. It was 1970, and the Steelers were looking to reshape their broadcasts, not to mention their image.
In those days, you see, broadcasters, almost without exception, rode the fence. So I said, if I'm going to do the games, I got to tell you right now that if the ball club is doing good, I'll be thrilled in the broadcast because I'm a fan, too. I said, if the ball club is out doing lousy, stinking up the joint, I'm going to say in the broadcast, these guys are stinking out the joint.
The timing was fortuitous.
Oh, he had to go up for that football. He had tough single coverage with help coming as he beat Pat Thomas going up for that ball. Cromwell coming across to try to break up the pass. Couldn't do it. Bradshaw, on his first attempt of the long bomb in this game, has hit one for the TD.
Steelers marched through the 70s, winning four Super Bowls, with Cope describing the team's exploits to the fans as the analyst, going so far as to introduce a weapon capable of bringing down the opposition with just the wave of a towel.
Big talk from the Dallas Cowboys, who don't seem to recognize that they're going up against perhaps the greatest Steeler team of all, who don't seem to recognize that they are also going up against a force as mysterious and deadly as the Bermuda Triangle, the terrible towel.
The towel and the Steeler broadcast brought Myron national acclaim. But to his listeners in Pittsburgh, he's just as famous for his radio talk show.
In the beginning, I thought this thing through. How am I going to do this show? What am I looking for here? And I decided that I wanted to do it just as if I were a kid again with the other kids standing on the corner in front of the neighborhood drugstore arguing about sports.
Now, do you got Cope here?
In a profession where a year is considered a long-term career, Myron Cope worked for the same call letters, WTAE, for over 30 years. It's a career that provided Pittsburgh with an inside look at sports' biggest personalities.
Myron, you're a little dramatic with this, I think.
Well, my life was at stake.
I mean, if you need to be on television, because they need to see your antics that you're going through.
I'm on.
I mean, you're all over the room here.
Well, I'm on television, but that has nothing to do with it.
And what is Myron's greatest thrill? Well, early in the Steelers' rise to power, Myron was awarded the task of inducting Frank Sinatra into Franco Harris's Italian Army. But if you know anything about old Blue Eyes, it was Myron's ultimate challenge.
And, you know, everybody was telling me through practice, you're a loser again, Cope. Sinatra's not here. You know, he didn't show up till like an hour later. He was sitting up in the stands the whole time by himself up in the bleachers watching practice and everything. And so, you know, everybody had me buried. There's 200 photographers. The word got around. They're all waiting for the first picture of Sinatra in 2 years. And we get Franco off the field. I barged into the middle of practice. Come on, Franco, you know. And we had this big ceremony, celebrated all night and everything like that. And it had to go down in this film.
Yes, there were times Our next speaker was a major part of those Super Bowls. We all admire his true grit style of play, and his courage and heart off the field. It's an honor to introduce this gentleman a day before Veterans Day. Ladies and gentlemen, let's welcome Rocky Blyer.
Jim, thank you very much, and ladies and gentlemen, indeed, it is a pleasure for me to be here, only to bring the truth out of what this man, who we are here to honor tonight, is all about. It's an amazing country we live in. Think about it. You spend hard-earned money. You took a night off. We are gathered here to pay tribute slash roast a man who has actually never done anything in his life to deserve it. Think about it. A man who has made a living off the hard work, sweat, and toil of other people. For you see, tonight, somewhere along the line, whether it be video or when Myron comes up, he will personally take credit for the success of every person on this dais. For you see, if he personally had not gone to Chaz himself to say that the best blocker that he has is sitting on the bench and he should play him, I would have never played. Obviously. It is his terrible towel, you will find out, that won 4 Super Bowls. His credits. But Myron, in all honesty, as we have viewed, is truly an anomaly. For you see, he is like the bumblebee, who is aeronautically designed not to fly. But since it doesn't know it can't fly, it flies. He's got short little legs that make him stand so low, you gotta pick him up to say hello. He's got a little car that goes beep, beep, beep. And of course, he's got that little voice that goes squeak, squeak, squeak. Now, the interesting thing is this, is that there is not an individual here tonight that not sometime in his life imitated this little man. And Myron, I'll tell you this. Imitation is the highest form of flattery. Then let it be known that it's just not flattery, that you are truly universally loved by all of us. God bless you.
Cope has had an influence on Steeler personnel decisions and also on the coaching staff. He calls himself Coach Cope. And I think he's kidding on the square. I think he really thinks that he knows as much football as those guys who spend 7 days a week putting X's and O's on the board and teaching the players technique. But seriously, yes, Myron was instrumental in urging them to take a second look at Rocky. Obviously, Carlton Hasselrig was his choice, thanks to Mr. Rooney saying, go ahead, Cope, you grab our last draft pick. And so, you know, he's had an influence on the coaching staff. They just don't want to admit it.
You know, he has a sense of humor that works very well, and he has this shtick that is a Pittsburgh thing. And I think the fans love him. I know the players like him. The coaches sometimes like him. But it's worked well, and Myron's done a great job.
Can't touch this. Can't touch this.
Yoy!
Touch this.
You can't touch this. My. Main coach ain't down from Montreal. Just hand him the ball. He knew it all. You can't touch this. Main coach Chico gobble up the ball. Chico the bell to bream. It's a DP scream. Sucker. The hitter's a sucker.
Can't touch this.
MC. Yoy. Take it from MC.
Can't touch this.
Of course not. You can bet your greenie you can't.
Can't touch this.
Bobby Bo, you put on a show. Take the Bobby Bo over to Bojo's. You can't touch this.
WTAE-TV, WDVE, A Salute to Myron Cope, is sponsored in partnership with Giant Eagle. Take the Giant to make life simple. Buy Subway. With over 100 locations in Western Pennsylvania, Subway, the way a sandwich should be. And by Sprint PCS, bringing the wireless internet into the palm of your hand.
As Pierre Bros again is stung, although he was running in very good coverage. As Pierre Bros was, but Nilo Donnelly put that ball right on the money, and Mills was able to take it in full stride, and the Steelers look like they may extend and come back from the jaws of defeat to the thrill of victory.
Bill and Myron have a unique relationship. If you watch the Tuesday press conferences, you no doubt know that the every now and then the two will have an exchange. And there was one in particular I was thinking about as I came up here. It was, I think, a couple of weeks ago. And Bill Cowher was talking about Dermonte Dawson missing the game. And he went on to say, for my money, Dermonte Dawson is the best center in NFL history. Well, and I think a lot of people do agree. Myron, though, has the advantage of knowing football from further back than 1988. And he stood up and raised his hand and said, Coach, what about Bulldog Turner? And Coach Cowher's like, who, Myron? Bulldog Turner, the old Chicago Bears. And Coach Cowher's just like, I don't really know him. Tell me a little bit about him. So he describes Bulldog Turner, who went both ways, back in the, I'm going to guess, the 30s?
Oh, yeah,
30s? Okay, a little bit before my time, too. And Coach Cowher was just like, well, I didn't mean to offend you, Myron. I obviously didn't see the man play. But every now and then, they have those converse exchanges, and I think it's a mutual admiration society. So without further ado, ladies and gentlemen, Steeler head coach Bill Cowher.
You know, it's interesting that that they're doing this for you after 30 years, and I know since I've come back here to Pittsburgh in 1992, I've had the pleasure, really, of working with you on my on our pregame show. And having done this for 8 years, and, you know, we've kind of gotten pretty good at it. And I know that because of, maybe it's the age factor, but I've kind of taken over the producer responsibilities. Now I'm in charge of making sure you start your stopwatch on time and that you have your cue cards right where they need to be so we don't have to go through two or three takes as we did a couple times earlier on. But I think we've become a pretty good team. And I really would like to say, Myron, that, you know, in a world of sports today that has been identified with change, whether it be coaches and players, the fact that, you know, you are a Pittsburgh person, and I think anybody that thinks about the Pittsburgh Steelers, and I know growing up that we used to listen to the games on radio, and that's because we couldn't get tickets and it wasn't always shown on TV, that you will forever be identified as the voice of the Pittsburgh Steelers. And, you know, with change, the fact that you've been here for 30 years, still going strong, and I can say that because I've worked with you weekly. I think it's refreshing. I think the fact that they have tonight for you is very deserving. And I think that without question, when you think of Pittsburgh and you think about all the things that are traditional, Myron Cope will always be something that's identified with this great city. Enjoy tonight. Congratulations. And I'm sure when you get the mic, it's going to be a late night for everybody tonight. So sit back, ladies and gentlemen, and enjoy with all the events that take place tonight. Congrats, Myron. I can't be there, but you're always going to be in our thoughts.
Playing golf with Cope is an adventure because of the constant commentary, which is complete with proper punctuation, normally good grammar.
Slow down. Get in the hole. Ah!
Sometimes he bends the King's English a little bit, but he really knows the King's English. And so, therefore, I guess he figures that he can have more liberties than other people. So, golfing with him, you get that constant commentary, and you think that you're on TV with every shot.
Oh, my goodness. Let's see.
It's moving in. That's dropping.
You got off a five with
what? What happened?
It fell in. Did that fall in?
Ryan was walking around. Is that good?
Less than 10 seconds.
What do you mean? Was anybody clocking it?
That's unbelievable. Not only did I win the hole following his complete unnerving with the exploding golf ball, we had some fun, and he never did see that we switched the balls. Thank you to the pro, the lady pro, who said, Myron, at the right time to get his attention and get him distracted, that I could jump in and switch the balls. It worked to perfection.
What the hell is that? You smoked that one, Coke! You smoked that one!
Stay with us. More of A Salute to Myron Coke continues.
And I'm very proud of my father for 30 years in broadcasting. He's worked very hard for it, and I know that he has. I've seen him work. When I was growing up, he worked long hours, didn't get home till 9 or 10 o'clock at night. I feel like I should be getting some kind of award, though, for putting up with them for 28 years.
You know, I'm a huge fan of Myron's. In fact, I have a life-size photo of Myron that I carry around in my wallet. And he's great to have at cocktail parties because there's always a place to put your glass. Now, look, you know, I think Myron, you know, looks terrific. I mean, here he is, 82, in his 70s or whatever it is, and he looks great, particularly when you think about the amount of stress that this gentleman has had in his life. But here's a guy, you can imagine the stress, who made a living talking about something he knew absolutely nothing about. I mean, it's incredible. Now, one last story I wanted to tell you is back in the early 70s, Myron came to me and to a number of other stewards to ask us our opinion of something. And he walked up and he said, Russell, I want to know where I got this idea. I said, what's your idea, Myron? He said, I got this idea. We're going to have these gold and black flags and we'll have them shake them. And I said, Myron, we're not a gimmick football team. We don't need flags. We don't need that. We're a serious football team. We've got the talent to win. We don't need gimmicks. That's the dumbest idea I ever heard of. Your terrible towel. Forget it. Well, we all know what happened, of course. And you know, I just want to say, you know, Myron is a true professional, and we always had great respect for him because he did his homework, he worked hard, and I'm going to do something now that I've never ever done before, in a tribute to Myron.
Harry Holmes was defending his title at the Civic Arena, but I was invited to be the ring announcer, and I immediately accepted because we did a feature where I went over to Carnegie Mellon. I had this idea that I would go over there, and it being a famous drama school, I would take elocution lessons at Carnegie Mellon. This English lady was given the assignment to teach me how to speak.
Wearing the purple trunks with a white stripe. Hello, Kate, teacher.
Myron, this is Pittsburgh. We do purple here. Purple.
And the fight was being nationally telecast with Howard Cosell at ringside. And as I was introducing the fighters, you know, Cosell said on television, the diminutive one is living out his fantasy.
Weighing 213 1/4 pounds, Larry Holt!
The Oakland Raiders, owned by the hated Al Davis, were playing a meaningless game at the end of the season against the Cincy Bungles. In any event, I simply said on the air, if the Oakland Raiders win this game, I'll swim them on. They won the game. I swam them on.
This year, two great brave people, Dewey Peterson, trying to go across the Atlantic in an air balloon, and Myron Cope successfully going across the Mon River.
I'll tell you, that Monongahela, that filth in there, it's foul. So what I need to clean me off is a terrible towel.
Well, we happen to have one just like that right here. Right there, a terrible, terrible towel. King of the promos, yes.
Yoy! Here comes the bus, and he goes through a hole. He's on a roll. He's at the 45, the 40, the 35, the 30, the 25, the 20. The bus is going express. It's intercepted at the 13-yard line. It is Rod Woodson who stepped in front of Eddie Kennison, and we're going the other way. 20, 15, 10. Eric Pingram goes all the way for that Steeler touchdown.
Yoy! Mania, there's nothing zany. If fans go bonkers, you can hear them in yonkers. Eat your kielbasa, drink your brewski, drink your Wolfsapski, we've got the last Lasky. Boom with them, stand with them, and if they're good, they'll cover your fancy. Jerome Bettis, Jerome Bettis, sure he's the real thing, he ain't no head of lettuce. He is one top cuss all aboard a big bus.
Jerome
Bettis. Wee Pegram, Pee Wee Pegram, give the ball to Pee Wee opponents, hide in TP. Give the ball to Pee Wee opponents, gonna wee wee yoy, David Pegram. Now don't you rebuttal Tom Zack on Critic Ditka, he got the last jack. Ditka don't like him, we'll take him. He can throw it clear to Hackensack.
I am not trying to seduce you.
Don't be bashful.
Oh, my.
Yoy, Von Kirkland, love Von Kirkland. One big bruiser, take him on, you're a loose.
Salute to Myron Cope, your Super Bowl station, WTAE-TV, Channel 4. Catch all the Super Bowl action on Sunday, starting with special pregame coverage beginning at 2 p.m.
And before I leave, I got to do something here. It's just give Myron his Steeler jersey, which I don't think you have one of these, which has your name on the back. It's quite nice. It's a little bit smaller than Bettis's, but...
Saturday!
Come on, you got to put it on. You got to put it on.
Over my cup.
Yeah. Over your cup. Come on. Come on, put it in.
Well, you got to put your arms through.
Oh. Come on. Put your arms. Come on. Come on,
man. I got a tuxedo on.
Oh, come on now. You can do it.
I got a tuxedo on.
It's all right.
It took me an hour.
Hey, hey.
My goodness. Thank you so much, ladies and gentlemen. I saw so many of my friends here tonight when I was before we convened for dinner, and it's great of you to turn out. I really appreciate it. And Andrew and Mr. Kren, what a masterful job of toastmastering. You know, Tunch joined our team as the third man in the booth last year. And when I say third man in the booth, let me make something clear. And I mean this. I have always felt that the first man in the booth is the play-by-play man. He's the rock on which the whole broadcast rests. And I've been so fortunate that in 30 years, I've only worked with two play-by-play men, both of them great, Jack Fleming and Bill Hillgrove, indeed. So the only reason I would refer to Tunch as the third man in the booth is because Bill and I got there first and have the chairs. But I really must respond to these assertions on the part of Russell and Blair and Ilkin that football is foreign to me. And so, as Blair alluded to the particular time, he glossed over it, seeking to run around the truth.
But the fact of the matter is, I made him. And from that day on, it was Rocky and Franco in that backfield. And I tell you what, he got his biography written, a book about him. He had a movie made about him, and he ran for 1,000 yards when it worked. And when you needed a pass real bad, yeah. Now you take Russell. Thank you so much for this. This is wonderful. I spent an hour and a half trying to get into a monkey suit. I'm perspiring and everything I get, and you put a football jersey on me before I big oration. He used to argue bitterly with me while he was a player, because he was so much into technique, you see, and all the fine points of football. And he'd say, "Cope, you don't even know what a cover two is." And I'd say, "Hey, I know what a cover two is, but more importantly, I know a slow linebacker when I see one." So they played Baltimore, and Baltimore fumbled at the Steelers' 7-yard line. And Russell picked up the fumble and headed over to the right sideline. He was slow as molasses to begin with, but this day playing on a gimpy knee. But 10 men formed alongside of him, a cordon of 10 blockers, and he headed up that right sideline, and 5 minutes later, he crossed the goal line. And established a National Football League playoff record, the longest touchdown return, 73 yards, the longest return of a fumble in playoff history. But I would like to thank my dear daughter Elizabeth for your nice words tonight. Love you. And all my family, some of whom came in from Buffalo for this. I'd like to recognize all my friends here, but golly, we'd be here so long it would be like Rocky Byer telling another story. So I do thank each and every one of you and all you terrific roasters. This is Myron Cope on sports.
In 1969, when I first heard Cope on the radio, I said, "Well, it's colorful and it's interesting. I wonder if he can sustain it." Well, not only did he sustain it, but he built on the comic. Then he branched into television and was a success there. And then he did the talk show, which he basically invented for talk radio in the town, and took it to the highest level and a new level that we'd never been. So, no, I was wrong. I didn't think he'd last very long. I thought with all that energy, that meter would be short-lived. Describing my time with Cope. Totally interesting. Totally adventuresome. Fun, because I think that's what the guy is all about. He does things in a very accurate manner, but he always makes sure that the listener has fun. Well, heck, if the listener's having fun, how about the people who are sitting next to him? We have to have fun. And I think that describes him as probably aptly as I can. Thanks, Myron. Thanks for the memories. I'd sing that famous Bob Hope theme song, but I know I couldn't cut it like you do.